So, good evening, everyone. This is the story of reversal of local extinction of Gaur in Bandhavgarh, which I think is a leading example of public-private partnership to achieve conservation victories. So, this picture is from somewhere in South India of a Gaur. I just put this picture here to show you the sheer size of this animal. Most of you must have seen Gaur or have heard about Gaur or have seen pictures. It's one of the largest wild cattle found in the world. And unfortunately, Gaur got extinct in Bandhavgarh in 1998. The exact reasons for disappearance of Gaur was not documented, but the most popularly accepted theory was that the species suffered some major setbacks in its monsoon range in 95 and did not return to the popular areas of the park after the monsoon. So, after 95 to 98, they slowly vanished and were not to be seen after that. Coincidentally, when this happened, I was working with Taj Safaris, which was a joint venture between Taj Group of Hotels and a South African company called And Beyond, which was earlier known as Conservation Corporation of Africa. And I happened to join as head naturalist with Taj Safaris. And during our interactions with Dr. Pabla, who was heading the Madhya Pradesh Forest Department as Chief Wildlife Warden, I happened to be with Sarat Champati, who was the Chief Naturalist and Head of Training for Taj Safaris. And sitting in his office, we discussed about, Madhya Pradesh Forest Department's plan to reverse the local extinction of Gaur. And during that discussion, an interesting thing came up that And Beyond has expertise in moving thousands and thousands of animals since they have started. And a proposal was mooted out to the Forest Department by Sarat that maybe we can join hands together and bring in the expertise from South Africa to make this, ambitious project see the light of the day. Dr. Pabla readily agreed and it started as a partnership between Taj Safaris and Madhya Pradesh Forest Department. Madhya Pradesh Forest Department also roped in Wildlife Institute of India, and the preparations for the project began. The project began in 2006, but easier said than done. It took almost 5 years to hold the first Gaur by its horns, and there's a long list of things that needed to be done before we could start catching animals. And just to briefly tell you about the preparations that went in before starting to capture these animals, Madhya Pradesh Forest Department tried to establish the history of Gaur presence in Bandhavgarh Tiger Reserve, causes of local extinction, justification for reintroduction in Bandhavgarh, a feasibility study done by Wildlife Institute of India, the food and water requirements of Gaur at Bandhavgarh, permissions for translocation of Gaur, which was absolutely critical because both the places were tiger reserves and it needed clearances from National Tiger Conservation Authority, procurement of licenses for importing drugs and other equipment which didn't exist in our country, training of personnel on how to do it and what to expect when we are actually catching real animals. Simulation of Gaur population viability analysis was done by Wildlife Institute of India. We went to Africa and saw transport trucks and containers. So designing of those transport trucks and containers in India, designing of stretchers to carry animals, capture enclosures, loading ramps, release enclosures on Bandhavgarh, procurement of radio collars, development of veterinary protocols. So, there was a long list of things that needed to be done before we were, ready to catch these animals. In 2008, a delegation of officers from Madhya Pradesh Forest Department, along with Sarat and myself, we went to Africa. We were hosted by And Beyond there, and park directors and veterinary officers from Madhya Pradesh Forest Department and Wildlife Institute of India got a first-hand experience and interacted with some of the brilliant, you know, officers, capture managers and veterinarians there and saw their facilities. In this picture, you can see the delegation is interacting with Steve Whitefield, who was a section ranger at Kruger National Park, who gave us an understanding of how microlights are used in wildlife management and grassland management in Kruger. We understood their protection and anti-poaching protocols, how do they carry out anti-poaching in those areas. We also went and witnessed their facilities at Skukuza, where they have these holding pens where wildlife is captured and later on auctioned to an industry which either has a tourism mandate or they have a hunting mandate. So this is where the animals are captured, animals are brought in, and the government auctions these animals to private players. Completely different scenario from what we have in our country, but it was interesting to see all this. We also understood the detailed infrastructure which is required in moving these large animals. And in this picture, Jeff Cook, who was the head of game capture unit in KwaZulu-Natal Wildlife Services, explaining us, you know, how they manufacture and kind of designs that they use for transport trucks. The delegation also got an understanding of how buffaloes are mass captured in Africa in order to address the problem of tuberculosis in the wild population. So how mass capture of buffaloes is carried out, how these animals are kept in quarantine for a few days, how blood samples are drawn from these wild animals, until the reports from these blood samples come back, they are held in captivity, and all the positive animals who are found positive of tuberculosis are moved aside and eliminated from the wild population and rest released back into the wild. So this is all the heavy equipment that is required in carrying out these mass capture operations and addressing problem of tuberculosis in wild buffaloes in South Africa. The team also participated in a buffalo darting and moving operation, where a buffalo was captured in Pinda Private Game Reserves and locally translocated to another part of the park to get an understanding of what to expect when you are actually catching large animals like gaur before, because buffalo was more or less close to the animals that we were planning to capture here in India. And then the team came back with a learning from there, and we sat down with some designers in Jabalpur to manufacture transport trucks exactly on the lines of how they are manufactured in South Africa. And Tata Motors kindly donated two trucks for the project. One was a big transport truck in which the animals were supposed to be moved. And the other one was a small 4x4 recovery truck, which was we intended to use for moving animals when they were caught inside in areas where big trucks cannot go. A 100-hectare plot was set aside as a release enclosure in Bandhavgarh, which was completely fenced with a chain link fence and also offsets of solar power, so that once the animals they come to Bandhavgarh, they are confined to an area before they are ready to be released back into the wild. So this is again a picture of the fence of that 100-hectare plot in Bandhavgarh. the gentleman standing in the middle is the then director of Bandhavgarh Tiger Reserve, Mr. Patil, and that's the entrance of the release pen, which was ready in December 2010. Then the South African experts also, you know, were excited that they are going to approach the animals from elephant back, because in Africa, largely either they use vehicles or helicopters to dart these animals. But in India, elephants proved out to be a very valuable asset in approaching these animals and darting these animals. So we did some trial runs where we approached these animals and saw how close we could get to those. And everyone was so elated that we can really approach these animals very well on elephant back, even if they move inside dense forest where vehicles cannot go and where there's a no chance of helicopters being used. In 2008, India was still using some different type of tranquilizing equipment. So we got introduced to some of the finest of the tranquilizing equipment in South Africa, and a state-of-art tranquilizing equipment was imported to India, which now I think almost every forest department in the country is using. These are the Dan Inject guns, which came to India for the first time during this project. As I mentioned earlier, Tata Motors donated two trucks to us. This was the second 4x4 truck donated by Tata Motors, which was a recovery truck, and that was further modified in Jabalpur. And that's the truck after it was fully modified and ready to be brought down to Kana. We also got some stretchers manufactured in Mandla. These stretchers were made out of hollow poles, which could take some extension rods. And the idea was that once the animal is sedated, the idea was to bring the gore on the stretcher so that at least 20 to 25 people can lift that animal from wherever it is darted onto a small recovery truck and later onto a big truck or directly to the capture enclosure. Now, this was the design of the capture pen, which was manufactured or erected in Kana Tiger Reserve. So here you can see it is a teardrop shaped capture enclosure with these are the sliding gates here. There was a gate here which could be opened from outside, and there was another sliding gate here, and the loading ramp which eventually ended into the truck. Let us assume that we caught some animals in this area of the park. We loaded the animal onto a stretcher, onto a small recovery truck, and we drove the truck straight from the field to this place. This gate was opened, the animal was brought in here, and later the animal was processed, whether it was to be installed with a radio collar by scientists from Wildlife Institute of India, or to take some parameters like blood samples and administering more tranquilizers, and then eventually administered with antidote. Once the antidote was administered, both these gates were opened and the animal was brought here into this holding area. We repeated the process again and again, and once we had a truck full of animals in this area, both these gates were opened, this gate was opened, and the animal were pushed into the truck, and then off they went to Bandhavgarh. So this is the capture enclosure in Kana, which is being erected. We selected a small patch of sal forest, which gave the feel of still being in the forest to the animals when they were captured. And then later on, so that we can move them into the truck from here. So in this picture, you can see Les Carlyle, the gentleman with the white beard, who was the group conservation manager for And Beyond, along with Sarat and range forest officer Mr. Kari from Kana. And this is the capture enclosure under construction in Kanha National Park. And finally, the trucks properly positioned after the manufacturing of or the erection of the capture enclosure was over, so that we are ready to start catching animals in the field. Now, in January 2011, the first day of operation was 20th January 2011, almost 5 years after we started planning and preparing for this project. And in this picture, you can see Dr. Dave Cooper, who was the chief veterinarian from South Africa, KZN Wildlife Services, is discussing the detailed veterinary protocols with the veterinary officers from Madhya Pradesh Forest Department, because the drugs that we were intending to use on these animals were extremely lethal and had the potential to not only kill animals, but also potential to kill people if any kind of ignorance was there as far as handling these drugs was concerned. And also the detailed procedures to be followed, right from selection of the animal, ocular estimation of the drugs, because all these drugs have to be, the darts have to be prepared based on the weight of these animals. So all these discussions going on between Dr. Dave Cooper and the veterinarians from Wildlife Institute of India and Madhya Pradesh Forest Department. And after all those protocols were finally discussed, off we went looking for animals to be picked up from Kanha National Park. So in this picture, you can see Field Director Mr. Nagy of Kanha National Park, along with Les, selecting the animals that they thought were the best animals to be sent to Bandhavgarh, because Field Director Kanha was on the donating side, and they decided which would be the best animals to be sent to Bandhavgarh. So there's a best chance of these animals going and breeding well on the other side. And in this picture, you can see the first animal being darted from the elephant back. And after this animal was darted, to our surprise, the animal slowly moved towards a nala and fell down into that nala and rolled onto its back into an extremely awkward position. And normally when you are dealing with herbivores, tranquilizing herbivores, such things can be extremely dangerous, and there's a chance of animal losing its life if the animal is left lying in this position for a long, long time. But the African experts and the Indian teams were quick to respond. And here you can see Les Carlisle and Field Director of Kanha quickly reaching to the tranquilized animal and trying to bring the animal into the right position, into sternal recumbency position, so that the animal doesn't develop complications. And once a proper position for the animal was established, once the animal was blindfolded so that the reflexes, it cannot see what is happening around it, the stretcher teams are brought in, because then you need to lift the tranquilized animal onto a stretcher and then onto a truck. And now we are dealing with large animals which are weighing about, this particular animal must have been at least 300 to 400 kilos, and we caught some bigger animals as well, which weighed up to 700 to 800 kilos. So you can understand, you are dealing with animals which are extremely heavy, and the teams have to be well prepared and what to expect. So we had done some trial runs with our team, not with real animals, but with the help of some sandbags, and they were briefed in detail what to expect when we start catching our first animal. So this was our first animal, and quickly the stretcher team responded, and they were well aware of the technique on how to load the animal onto a stretcher. And here you can see the stretcher team trying to bring the gore onto a stretcher. And once the animal was brought into a stretcher, it was trapped with proper ropes and lifted out of the nala with the help of the extension rods, which could be inserted into a stretcher. So you can see this animal being moved out of the nala, and you can see the recovery truck standing in the background. Here, the gaur is safely being loaded onto a recovery truck. And once the animal was onto a recovery truck, the animal was quickly moved to the capture enclosure without wasting any time. On the right side, you can also see a weighing scale hanging onto a tree. So we tried to weigh the animals which we could manage to, because all the animals were beyond our capacity to weigh. But some animals which we could manage, we tried weighing them. And here in this picture, you can see the animal being, the stretcher of the animal being hooked to a weighing scale under a tree. And then later on, again, the stretcher was moved to a truck and back to the capture enclosure. As I said to you earlier, maintenance of sternal recumbency is extremely critical and important when you are tranquilizing and dealing with sedated herbivores. So here, holding the animal by its horns, maintaining the sternal recumbency of the animal. And then once the animal is brought into the capture enclosure, Dr. Shankar from Wildlife Institute of India deploying a radio collar onto an animal. And after a radio collar is deployed, after the animal is administered with all the necessary tranquilizers, which are required to keep the animal calm for next, 24 hours, 1 week and 1 month were done. All the samples collected, like blood samples, hair samples, or whatever samples, veterinarians and the teams wanted to collect. The animal was given an antidote and the animal was woken up. And when I say this, all this happened within 20 to 25 minutes of darting the animal. So you can understand, how quick the process is. And as we went ahead catching more and more animals, the team started getting better and better in adapting to their roles. And here you can see the first gaur captured is nicely standing into the capture enclosure. We repeated this exercise 6 times on the first day. And once we had a lot full, a lot of 5 gaur was loaded into the truck and it was ready to go to Bandhavgarh. So the first convoy was loaded with 5 gaur and it headed to Kanha. It was a 10-hour long journey. And when it reached there, it was dark. And for the first time after 13 years, Bandhavgarh got back first 5 gaur from Kanha. We repeated this exercise again and again. In 2011, 19 animals were caught. And again in 2012, department caught 31 more animals. And a total of 50 animals were moved from Kanha to Bandhavgarh between 2011 and 2012. Sarath, while he was trying to take picture of a gaur coming out of the truck, was surprised because this buffalo, this gaur, when it came out, it straight charged at him. But fortunately, he was behind a fence, so there was no real danger. And here in this picture, you can see the team proudly standing with gaur moved to Bandhavgarh, 19 gaur moved to Bandhavgarh. You can see Dr. Pabla standing in the middle. To Dr. Pabla's right is Jeff Cook, who was head of game capture in KZN Wildlife Services. To Jeff's right is Dr. Les Carlisle, who was head of head of conservation and beyond. The gentleman on the extreme left with the camera strapped around his neck is Dr. C.K. Patel, who was the director of Bandhavgarh Tiger Reserve. On Dr. Spabla's left is Dr. Dave Cooper, head veterinarian from KZN. Mridula, who was the director of operation for Taj Safaris, Mohantaji, who was deputy director Kanha Tiger Reserve, and Sarath, who was one of the main architects of this project from Taj Safaris side. In this picture, you can see this animal didn't go down well. Probably the drug didn't administer well, or maybe the drug dose was slightly less, and Les had to walk up to this animal and bring this animal down, holding its horns and its right ear. So here I would like to end my talk by saying, after we moved 50 animals to Bandhavgarh, the current population of Gaur in Bandhavgarh is more than 150 animals approximately, and there is an increase in population of 300% in last eight years. And personally, according to me, this Gaur project proved out to be a harbinger of change in our approach towards conservation. Madhya Pradesh Forest Department moved ahead with the learnings from this project and successfully created a second home for Barasingha in Satpura Tiger Reserve. So that was another feather in the cap of Madhya Pradesh Forest Department, which was under the leadership of the subsequent forest officers. I think Dr. Suhas Kumar was involved, Chauhan Saab, Shukla Saab were involved. And I can proudly say that Madhya Pradesh has created a second home for Barasingha in Satpura. Gaur project, personally, in my mind, without doubt, has the distinction of one of the finest examples of public-private partnership to achieve conservation victories, where revenues earned out of tourism were directly pumped back into conservation. And when I say that revenues earned out of tourism, it is not just And Beyond and Taj Safaris, but also Madhya Pradesh Forest Department. Every penny spent by Madhya Pradesh Forest Department on this project was actually came from the park receipts that the Madhya Pradesh Forest Department earns out of tourism in tiger reserves in central India. And I sincerely hope we achieve more of such conservation victories working together, and let's hope that adaptive and proactive management becomes the hallmark of modern day PA management in India. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It was fantastic. Let's bring in Dr. Pabla and Sarath.
May I request Dr. Pabla sir to say a few words, and also the challenges that you faced in executing this project. And after Dr. Pabla, I will request Sarath Champathy to say a few words in the challenges that he faced and the potential that he sees with such kind of partnerships in conservation. And then after that, we'll be happy to take question and answers from the participants.
Okay. Should I come in?
Yes, sir. Yeah, over to you.
Okay. Thank you, David, and thank you, Kartike. Kartike, you have summed it up very well. I think Gaur project has become the foundation of what I would say new conservation in not only Madhya Pradesh, maybe the whole of India now. And I think it was just sheer luck that we were able to do it. Because until then, we hadn't done anything like this, this one. Secondly, we never thought we could actually do it ever. Many times we had tried to handle animals, but by and large, they were all failures, and Gaur was considered to be a very tender animal. And so everybody advised us, don't go into this. But I think, as I said, it was sheer luck. Three factors played a major role. Number one, I came into the wildlife wing, not as the chief wildlife warden, but as additional PCC of wildlife. And it was somehow my wish that we should get back whatever we had lost in the past from Madhya Pradesh. We had lost several species. We lost gaur from Bandhavgarh. We had lost black buck from Kanha. We had lost Barasingha from Pachmadi area. That was much long before. And I was thinking that unless we try to get these species back, slowly we'll start losing species from everywhere, and the losses will be much larger. So that was one accident that I, after 15 years of my absence from the wildlife wing, I came back to the wildlife wing. Secondly, Sarath and his company, Les Carlyle and beyond, they came into India, set up a tourism shop. So I was hoping that they will teach us something new about tourism, but at the same time, I wanted to capitalize on their expertise handling big game. Sarath and I met, I think, in Karnataka, even before he moved over to Taj Safaris. And when he came back, came and joined Taj Safaris and came to see me, I asked him, okay, you are going to earn big money from Madhya Pradesh. What are you going to do for us? He told me that the company has a lot of experience and expertise in movement of large mammals. So actually, my initial thought was that to use their expertise in reintroducing tiger in Madhav right. National Park. But because they were setting up shop first in Bandhavgarh, they ultimately set up four lodges in Madhya Pradesh. First was in Bandhavgarh. So Sarath was keen that they should do something in Bandhavgarh. We had a ready proposal. So I told them then, okay, let's try to get the gaur back to Bandhavgarh. I thought it was only a wild kind of a shot, but within I think 3-4 days he got back to me, and I told them, you have to do it at your own cost. We are not going to spend any money. He came back within about 3-4 days, said, I have talked to my company and they said they will do it. So that's how the partnership developed. And as we went along, we ran into trouble within our own system. After we had prepared for, I think, 3 years, and everything seemed to be set, and the date, actually, I think 19th of January 2010 was set as the D-date, and the South Africans, Les Carlyle and all our friends had booked their tickets. Our permission was cancelled from the Government of India. Why permission? Because it's a Schedule 1 animal, and capture of a Schedule 1 animal is equivalent to hunting, and all hunting permissions are issued by Government of India. So everything had to be kind of put back in cold storage, and by that time I had also been moved out of the wildlife wing. So we were desperate, but despite my being outside the wildlife wing, I was really desperate to see things moving. So I continued to talk to people in Delhi to try to help us, wrong, very angry letters to them. And the third accident, I think happy accident, was the presence of Mr. Jairam Ramesh as the minister. You never see a minister like him, a minister talking to chief wildlife wardens in the states and calling them, Pablo sir, what can I do for you? And I had some accidental meeting with him in Delhi. I mean, we ran into each other in the corridor. He said, what are you doing? Why don't you come to my room? So I went to his room, not the that day, but a few days later. And I asked him to get the car back into Bandhavgarh. So he pulled whatever strings he could, talked to his officers, and ultimately it happened. The critical part was not my job. My job was only to see that everything, the field people, the Kartike, Sarath, and Les Carlyle, and my team, they needed. We had a lot of technical issues as well. Sometime the last day, we discovered that one of the critical drugs was not in our repertoire. So we had to, I think it was, I always think it almost a world class, world record of speed. That within 1 week, we were able to get all the licenses from Government of India, but it was a narcotic. So all we needed all the licenses to get narcotics from abroad. And it had to be brought by somebody in person because that's the law. So we had to make sure that Dr. Cooper had it in his bag when he lands in Delhi, in Bombay. when India also you have to transport the narcotics is a huge risk for a foreigner. So we had to station our people in Bombay airport, tie up with the customs people so that there's no problem. And when ultimately the D-Day came, the first gaur, as you've seen, barely survived death. The second animal actually died. And third also, I think, ran into trouble. Dr. Cooper was sitting at the head of the animal and I was wondering, shivering as much as the gaur was shivering. But somehow, these South African fans were absolutely marvelous. The kind of expertise, kind of confidence they had. I looked at him worriedly. He said, "Don't worry, I'm here." So he had an injection. I think it's what was the name of the drug? I don't remember now. Maybe it come later. So he gave the injection. The animal was up and running. So I think the major part, I mean, although we got our gaur back to Bandhavgarh after 15 years, I was a park director and Bandhavgarh and Kanha both, and we had gaur in Bandhavgarh when I was there. And after that, I came to the wildlife wing, there was no gaur. So it was sad going to Bandhavgarh, not see the gaur there. So we got it. I think the even more significant gain to us was gaining experience and confidence in handling large mammals, which I think has been now internalized by our department, and they move, I think, several thousand animals each year now from one park to other. Wherever they have relocated villages, they created new habitats, so they, rather than waiting for nature to fill up those places, they are now moving spotted deer and nilgai and other animals from one place to another. I think it's a totally different world now than what we were living at that time. So thanks to Sarath and Les Kalail, Kartike, everybody. I think by and large, nobody flinched from helping us. Either we were slow, the government was slow, but and beyond Les and Sarath and Kartike, they were always there. Must put on record, Les, I think, made some 15 trips to India to ensure that our infrastructure was ready and is the right kind and our people are totally trained. And by the time it all started, I think it went off like clockwork. I think you guys all should see that little documentary we have made in-house. Not a very high quality document. I think it has the entire story. It's called Turning the Clock Back, the Bandhavgarh Gaur. It must be somewhere on YouTube most likely. So thank you everybody. And it's been wonderful to kind of go through those moments again. Thanks to Sarath and Kartike. I think probably that's all. I should stop. We don't have a lot of time. Thank you very much. All the best.
Thank you, sir. May I request Sarath to say a few words and then we can take a few questions if there are any.
Sure. Thank you, Kartikeya. Thank you, Pablo, sir. Such a nice summary of the whole project which you nicely gave. So I would just like to add that it's an amazing coming together of a leader like Dr. Pabla, who had the vision, and later on when the actual thing came, who had the guts and the capacity to actually implement the project, guts to fight with Government of India and get all the things, and then to implement it on the field. And then these two companies, that is Taj Safaris, which had a big heart, because it was just in the first year of the company being set up in Bandhavgarh. So where's the question of getting almost a crore of rupees? So it's a company with a big heart because, of course, it's a Tata Group company. So they always think of the bigger picture and charity and stuff like that. And then the other companies and beyond, which has the right mind, that is with expertise. So all the world-class expertise what they had. So a company with a big heart, with a great mind, and then the leader with a vision. So it's coming together of these three factors and forces which made this whole project actually take off. So, and then the second fact I would like to put on record is the thing that you could get the latest skill and experience and the equipment. For example, like you showed the slides of when you went to Africa, the latest trucks which they were using, we could see the how they were doing, get the designs and build them here. So literally leapfrogged. Otherwise, you know, they were also, it took some 30 years for them to come to this evolved design. So we could get that. And like you mentioned, the latest darting guns, the Dan-injected guns, and also the very latest drugs. So all that also was possible to bring in. And then finally, when the project actually took off, we could get the best expertise. Dr. Dave Cooper, I mean, what a man. I mean, he is one of the most experienced wildlife veterinarians in South Africa and therefore the world. And this man has moved 50,000 animals in his career. He had a heart surgery about just 6 months back. But his passion to do this project for India was so much that he was in action. He came and he was totally in action. So imagine 50,000 animals from a small duker to the biggest bull elephants from Kruger. This man had that experience. So we had him on the ground. We had Jeff Cook, like you mentioned. And then you had Les Carlyle. And what a team to have from South Africa, apart from the this thing. And then the Madhya Pradesh Forest Department just absorbed the whole the expertise, skills and all so well. An amazing team of vets. And of course, we had Dr. Param Nigam from Wildlife Institute of India. And then Dr. Shankar. So unbelievable. I mean, it's like, you know, everybody coming together to implement this beautiful project. And finally, I would like to add that the capacity building was our biggest objective, like Dr. Pabla mentioned. And that was that also went off so well, you know, and great to see Madhya Pradesh Forest Department doing all these relocations, like Barasingha, what the slides you showed, and then the black bucks and Cheetal and everything else. So that was the ultimate objective of this project, which went off so beautifully. So that's what I want to add. Thank you for having me on this talk. Kartikeya, back to you.
Thank you very much.
David, sorry to butt in. I think Dr. Raghu Chundawat raised his hand. So probably
sure.
Sir, I'm just unmuting you. Yeah. Can you hear me, Dr. Raghu? Sir?
Who?
Dr.
Raghu.
I just raised the hand to maybe ask something later. Let him finish and then I will come back.
Sure. Yeah, so from my side, I'm done. Kartikeya, over to you.
No, so we are ready to take questions. Dr. Chundawat has raised his hand, so we can take Dr. Chundawat's question.
I must congratulate all of you. It was fantastic. And it's actually very unique in a way that usually Forest Department raise your hand for a cooperation. From outside skills, which is rare thing to happen. So I must congratulate Madhya Pradesh Forest Department to do this. It's a tool, management tool, translocation. We need to learn quite a lot. But my questions are not related to translocations of animals and things like that. It's a technique we need, it will take time. But I kind of missed the early part of the talk because I had to go out. Is anybody hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we can hear you.
So it's related to the conservation side of it because the title was the reversal of local extinction. I have several questions, but I will restrict to that. One, I don't know, I may have missed it out, but why we lost the original population? And if we know, and then what we have done that it doesn't happen next? I'm not talking about the poaching or the management protection and something, but in terms of conservation. And then how are you looking at the, because the increase 300%, maybe initially it can happen, but after several generations, how are you looking at, how are you ensuring, was there a conservation plan for these founder population? How are we going to ensure that why we lost is not going to happen?
So, maybe I think I will request Dr. Pabla to answer that question because he would be in a better position to answer that question. As far as I know, so the exact reason for the disappearance of Gore was not documented. So So it was extremely difficult to get the exact, you know, reason of disappearance. We had to rely on a few popular theories, and that's about it.
There's a workshop.
Kartike, let me explain that. Naturally, when we started dreaming of getting God back, this question had to be addressed first. Why did we lose the population in the first place? You know, we lost this population somewhere around 95. Only one animal continued to live in Bandhavgarh until 1990. That was also a male. Now, it's very interesting story. When I came to Bandhavgarh as park director, two years before that, Bandhavgarh is only about 105 square kilometers. And when I came, the park had been extended to its current size, I think about 442 square kilometers. Until the park was expanded, it was believed that Gaur migrated during monsoon to the area which is called Gunguti area, about 100-150 kilometers away. Everybody thought that Gaur migrated to that area, and post monsoon they came back to the park, lived there until about early part of July, then they moved away. But when the park got expanded and we had a monitoring program 24 hours, our staff was supposed to record all sighting in their diaries, and then we used to analyze them at the end of the month. We found that during the monsoon also the Gaur used to be in the Kalwa Magdi part of the park, which earlier was not part of the park. So it did not migrate far away, although it did migrate locally. But that was known only to the park management, or maybe probably not even to the park management, maybe except me, because I was the only one at that time. We didn't have computers, we didn't have a lot of information dissemination system. So before we could complete that monitoring program, I was transferred, then I left that place, and maybe that information went away with me. So we had information, at least I knew that the animal did not migrate outside the park even during monsoon, that's one. But still, when we lost the population, everybody thought there were two theories. One, that animals migrated out and died out of a disease or something. A second was that large dam was built near Pali as a part of the thermal power project there, and the animals migrated outside and could not come back because of the construction or maybe the filling of that dam. But we wanted to be sure what happened actually to this population. So when we were preparing for this project, we called a meeting of all the former directors and deputy directors of the park between when I was there and until the day when we lost the animals. The very interesting thing came. Everybody thought that we had lost them in 95 when they had gone out of the park and did not come back. Our deputy director of the park, O.P. Tiwari, he showed me his diary. He said, "Sir, no, that year, on the day the park opened, there was a herd of 17 gaurs right at Tala Gate, and it was mentioned, recorded in his diary." So that means that theory that they had lost their way or died due to a disease outside the park in the monsoon of 95 was not true. Now, on the 1st of October, that time parks used to open on the 1st of October. On 1st of October, there was a herd of 17 at the gate. In February, a new director, Ms. R.C. Sharma, joined the park. In Febs, and he said that he saw only one gaur in February 96. So that means if both these records are true, we lost this population only somewhere between November 95 and February 96. So the only explanation that comes to my mind is, again, it's a conjecture, as Kartike said earlier, but probably it's based on these two recorded events, is that they were there in 95 And during the winter of 95, because it was a one herd, always one herd. Sometimes it broke up into two herds or something. Generally, there were only one single herd. They, I think, wandered out of the park into the croplands, where somehow they met with somewhere, maybe, and the herd got scattered. Either some of them were killed, poached, or maybe chased away by people, killed by dogs, or whatever. So whatever happened to them, it happened between November 95 and February 96. My guess is they got outside, the herd got scattered, and most of the animals died the individual deaths, but maybe due to various reasons. And one animal continued to live there for long. Now, second part of Raghu's question is, what is happening now? Although I'm not in touch now, but I think by and large the population has stabilized now about around 150. I've been hearing about the 150 number for the last 2 or 3 years. The regular mortality now, regular births now, animals are dying of predation. Some animals have also died of diseases. So by and large, population is now stable. And I don't think it's going to grow exponentially now. Probably will remain somewhere 150 or 200 animals, unless they occupy areas outside the park. Although now park areas much larger, even if Panpatha we include. But as you know, animals don't know boundaries. But 100 kilometers of the park boundary was fenced at the time. I don't know, they might have extended the park fence now, which I think played a very major role in the success of the project. Because controlling 50 animals when they wander outside the park, it was a hell of a serious job. Some animals did die about 50 kilometers away from the park in the first year itself. They started to probably walk back to Kana. It was a probably their homing instinct goaded them go back home. At least one female died about 50 kilometers away, I remember. So the fence held them back. And then our 24-hour monitoring, because we had elephants, we had a research team, 24-hour monitoring them. So whenever animals tried to go outside the park, we pulled them back. Then they of course, settled. So now, nobody knows of the future, but I think there's plenty of habitat now, by and large, for 150, 200 animals. It seems they have stabilized, but you never know. Yeah. Okay.
And Kartika, would you like to add about the research team, the Wildlife Institute students who were there, who monitored it for some 5 years?
Yeah. Fortunately, Navanithan, who did his PhD on Gaur, is also here. Okay. And maybe he can throw some light on what is happening with the population now. So Navanithan, can you hear me? Are you around?
Yes, sir, I'm here. Am I audible?
Yeah,
you are audible. Yeah, over to you.
Throw some light on, because after we actually physically moved the animals, you know, myself, Sarath, and also after a while, Dr. Pabla were not directly involved, but you continue to monitor these animals for, I think, 3 or 4 years. So would you like to add something to it?
Yes, sure. Good evening, everyone. And good evening, sir. Thanks for this opportunity. I monitored this Gaur for almost 7 years, from 2011 to 2017, end of 2017. As explained initially, of this 50 individuals, we radio collared 27 individuals. Of these 27 radio collars, 21 are VHF and remaining 6 are GPS satellite collars. So we also used ground tracking to track these individuals. So these radio collars helped a lot. As Pabla sir also said, this fencing, the virtual fencing, that also helped a lot to keep the animal inside the national park. So the first year, 19 individuals, we brought and we kept it for almost 2 months to get this local accommodation of Bandhavgarh. Then later on it released, and initial, like for 1 year, almost there were one or two predations of this entire population. So at the end of first year, we had around 18 individuals. We had one birth. So what is the advantage of using this advanced drugs and so many expertise? We also carried pregnant individuals. So the carrying individuals, almost 5 to 6 months individuals. So that's also a new achievement for this Gaur project. And to supplement these 50 individuals as a carrying capacity for Bandhavgarh, so as I said, 31 individuals has been translocated in Bandhavgarh in the second year. And we continued monitoring, and there were hardly for next 2 years, we monitored very intensively. We had congregated of 4 herds. So initially there were 6 herds, all small herds had their own farming. They were mostly ranging in the southern part of the park, that is Tala, Magdi and Kalwa. So these are the main. And one more highlight of this GOR project, where villages, the resident villages inside the national park got translocated. So as a scientific part, the freeing of wildlife habitat, which had accumulated this GOR population. So that also helped a lot of translocation of villages. So freeing by space and giving the natural habitat to these individuals helped a lot to settle, to locally settle. So at the end of third year, we had a population around 80, 85 individuals. Then these radio collars stopped working. So what is the next step? How do we monitor these individuals without the help of radio collar? So while we monitoring these individuals with the radio collar, we know that at a certain point, this technology might stop. So we need to have this virtual kind of monitoring, like how do we monitor? So based on this horn structure, horn size, horn curvature, body size, we identified individuals. So in a herd of 12 individuals, we could easily identify 5 to 6 solid individuals. So based on these individuals, we locally named this Tala herd, Magdi herd, Magdi 1, Magdi 2, these kind of herds. So these help, these identifying of these herds and also training forest department staffs, each beat, like every month we have a meeting like for a particular ranges. So this helped from a scientific part as well as a management part, both as an equal balance of this monitoring. So when the research team is not monitoring, the management takes the lead. So where the park directors made such a big command of helping the research team as well as the management. So at the end of seventh year, I would say like the population was around 140, 145 individuals. The predation rate was high. Like initially it was like one or two individuals here, and now it's almost 10 to 12 individuals per year.
Okay, may I interrupt you, Navaneethan here? I think Dr. Chundawat says that we are missing the point, and he wants to come back to ask the question in a much more, clear manner. So can we take Dr. Chundawat's question and then come to the rest of the details?
Yes, sir, please.
Yes, over to him.
Dr. Chundawat.
Can you hear?
Yeah, clear.
Yeah, no, my point is looking at from the past and to in the future. The thing is, look at it, GOR distribution in north of Narmada is all isolated population. They are not connected. When we talk about tigers, we talk about connectivities, important for viability of local population. You have created a founder population which is growing. Now, maybe initial few generation, 10, 20, in an increase, then you will have inbreeding. If it's isolated population, you will have genetic drift and you have the same problem. Point what Pablaza was describing was that what I gather from there, because this was an isolated population. We don't know the exact cause of what has happened, but we can take it from there that it's an isolated population with no connectivity. small population syndrome caused the extinction. We have established a founder population, but we have not established a connectivity. We have not sorted out. So neighboring populations, where they are, how are you going to connect them? Those may be the very for so that it not only for 10 generations is popular and then you start seeing higher mortalities. We need to have our artificial individuals coming in, introduced in the population. We need to create that. So the neighboring population where they are, or if they are not in connected zone, then we have neighboring populations. There's just one isolated population, maybe a not a long-term view. That's what I wanted to understand. Is there a
completely got your point? That? And I think this needs to be taken into consideration if we have to ensure that the population stays in Bandhavgarh for a long, long time. So this was, I think this was.
Kartikeya, let me say a few words on that. Raghu, we have a very there's a connecting population going through Shahdol, Umaria, right up to Kanha, even South Balaghat area. Actually, when we were planning this, this project was opposed by a lot of people on the ground that we have a GOR in the neighborhood. Actually, Gunguti area had a population even then at the time. And some people even suggested that why are you taking up such a huge project? Why don't you just walk them into the park using Maua as a lure or something like that? So I think we have a population in the neighborhood. I don't know whether these populations got connected after that or not. Maybe it's just for somebody to find out. But I think in any case, by and large, even if there's now no connectivity, this is going to be an isolated population. I think because it's probably the northern end of its distribution in any case. I think, see, Gaur was found in almost all of southern Madhya Pradesh, but slowly this range has shrunk. It used to be found in Khandwa, Betul, all those areas, and maybe the connected areas of Maharashtra, but we don't have it there now. And similarly, in the north Madhya Pradesh, this around Bandhogarh, we had it in Sanjay National Park when I was in Panna. Sonakya sahab was in Sanjay, but we don't have it there now. I think the forest department now planning to reintroduce Gaur in Sanjay Tiger Reserve as well.
The point I was trying to make is that we've been getting into translocations quite a lot, as you said, individuals, but we're not doing it in a planned way. So in this case, there may be a connected population. Connected means connected through the habitat, not geographically connected, where there is dispersal or migration and emigration happening through population. So if maybe Bandhogarh will create a neighboring with different genetic contribution characteristics, a population where the exchange of individuals running. But it cannot be like a core and buffer population we are looking at. It has to be a discrete demographies, or if it's not possible, then we have to have a plan that every 5 years we exchange 10 or 5 individuals or things like that. Those are things very crucial for us.
I think that plan has to be there, because I think by and large these populations are going to stay isolated. Even if you have some animals migrating from here and there, but that may not be any guarantee of genetic exchange. By and large, we are going to have protected areas as the mainstay of these species. But outside populations are going to be very thin. So I think this program of regularly exchanging animals from one population to other, that should be part of the long-term plan.
Okay, sir. Sorry to butt in between. Kartike, there quite a few questions also piling up in the chat box. Can you quickly go through it, probably choose some of the relevant ones and we can answer it?
David. Yes. Can you take the questions?
You want me to read out?
Or do you want me to take the questions?
Yes, please.
The chat box. I can't see it.
Okay, I can see it.
So I think there's a question from Mayuresh Gangal.
Yeah.
I was just wondering how it was decided from which national park animals can be translocated for relocation. Also, how it was decided how many animals should go to Bandhavgarh. Was there any particular age structure, sex ratio? So, the decision to move animals was taken from Kana because A, Kana has good population of Gaur, and also it was connectivity wise, it was a decent drive distance from Kana to Bandhavgarh.
The nearest population.
And also how it was decided how many animals. I think Wildlife Institute of India did a population viability analysis where they exactly told us a broad structure on how many animals should be moved, what age structure and sex ratios. So that was taken into consideration. There's a question from Abhilash Ravi Mohanan. Is there any study regarding predation of the reintroduction introduced Gaur in Bandhavgarh? I think Navaneethan, who just now gave his views, has done his PhD. So he is the best person to get in touch with. Maybe David, we can link up Navaneethan with the participants who've been asking these questions over email, and if they want, they can exchange. PhD, his PhD notes or thesis.
Okay, he's already mentioned that there are 10-12 animals that are being...
Per year.
Yes, sir. Okay, he's there already. Yeah.
But we can get his email ID actually.
Yeah, of course. But
this is... How many animals are here? Can you just put in some information on it?
So it's like year-wise, initially, as like, I just want to give a small brief.
initially it was like very hard to get the predation rate also. Like there are 19 individuals and 50 individuals. When the population stable, more than 100, then the predation rate also got increased, where the tigers also got used to gauze. Before that, hardly one or two predations. Hardly say for first 3 years, there were only 5 predations. And after the fourth year, in the second phase, almost 3 years, there is around 36 predations. So that's how the predation rate has been increased. So we have monitored that. I would like to share that also. I'll give my email ID. So I'll share the notes in the chat box.
Yeah, thank you.
Also, David, Wildlife Institute of India came up with a detailed report on this project. And I can share that report with you. And you can send it to the participants who have registered on the talk to get an idea of other details. For example, Mayuresh, second question is, how did you use the blood samples and other parameters later on? I think blood samples were largely collected to ensure that there are no serious lethal diseases in these animals before we move them to Bandhavgarh National Park. Next question is, sir, unlike Africa, where such procedures are well documented in video format for educational purposes, why aren't we encouraging video documentation? Dr. Pabla mentioned that Forest Department has made a documentary on the project, and it is there on YouTube by the name of Turning the Clock Back. And I can send the link to you, David, and you can send it to the participants.
Yes.
Vidya Venkatesh is asking, and specifically to Dr. Pabla, do we think we now have the expertise in India to handle more large mammal relocation strategies? What would be your suggestion to build capacities for our wildlife team in India to handle more of such challenges in the coming years?
Vidya, I can't be sure whether we have it all. But I think we are much better than what we used to be earlier. And I'm not in touch now of how they have built their capacity. I think Madhya Pradesh Forest Department has fairly good capacity now. We have several very well-trained, very experienced veterinarians. Several officers also have had experience in these matters, and they regularly move cheetah at least from one park to other. I think they about 1,000, 2,000 they move every year. They moved even Nilgai, and then they moved Barasingha. So by and large, I think they have a fairly good capacity now. But other states, I'm not very sure how well they are prepared. Like say, for example, we at that time had only one transportation truck. Now we have, I think, more than half a dozen now in the forest part of Madhya Pradesh. So they can move 50, 100 animals per day if they want to. So yeah, by and large, I think if they use the expertise acquired by Madhya Pradesh Forest Department and before the veterinarians from WII retire, mm-hmm. I think not that we have everything, but I think we have some experience now.
Yeah. And again, one more question from Mayuresh was, that it would be interesting to know how Taj Group was involved in this initiative. Was the proposal from park authorities or they volunteered? It would be also great to know in what capacity they contributed to the initiative. Sarath, would you like to answer that question?
Sure. Dr. Pabla very well mentioned in his comment, saying that when he was the additional chief wildlife warden and we just moved to Madhya Pradesh and the company was started. And since we already met in Karnataka in a jungle lodges training, he came for that. So I went to meet him since I was in Madhya Pradesh for the first time, went to Bhopal to meet him because we already had met before. And that's where the initial he put that idea, like he mentioned, initially asked whether we can get involved in the tiger relocation to Madhav National Park. So that was a little too much of a high profile animal to get into. So then he said, how about Gaur? And I mentioned that we would like to do something in Bandhavgarh. So there was already a idea or a proposal on his desk about Gaur relocation. And that's how the whole thing started. Since we had the expertise and of course, like I said, I could convince Taj Safaris to get into this conservation get opportunity to get involved in a conservation initiative with MP Forest Department. That's how it started.
I think it was probably the mutual confidence between the Forest Department and the Thar Safaris and beyond,
correct,
which made this happen.
Absolutely.
And probably the stability of tenure in the wildlife wing also helped a little. Because if you have people who move out quickly, correct, and then are not able to build bridges with the new people, then naturally the processes suffer. Yeah,
absolutely. Agreed.
Thank you, Pablo sir and Sarat. Sushil Chikane has got a question. Can we take your question, Sushil?
I just unmuted him. Sushil?
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Over to you.
Thank you for the really interesting talk. My question is to actually Karthikeyan and Pablo sir, or even Navneet, who was involved in the research now. So when a species that has been missing for a landscape for more than a decade, there are the animal dynamics that changes with time, right? And now when we reintroduce them after a decade, has anybody been analyzing about how the animal interactions has changed? Because definitely introduction of a species which hasn't been there around for some time has affected the animal behavior of the place, right? So if you could enlighten us a little bit on that, or have there studied that aspect?
I think Navaneethan would be the best
person.
Yeah, I think before Navaneethan, I'll just butt in. I remember one of the guide told me when they saw a gaur, a sambar actually given an alarm call and ran away first time.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
Because there's a statistical model called the pre-predator model, where the whole ecology depends upon this model about the population density of animals. When we introduce a species that has been missing from the landscape, a lot of changes happen. So has Karthi, has Navneet studied that aspect of it, and what have been his observations?
Yes, sir. Like, shall I?
Yeah,
go ahead.
Yeah. As said, like initial days, even all the wild animals like cheetal, macaque, and common langur, they start giving alarm calls when they initially see these gaur species. And even tigers, they were not ready to hunt these gaurs because they have provoked and tried to re-attack. So these are the very interesting scenes where were the initial stage for these 19 individuals when we relocated and started studying what are the associated species were coming together. That was very interesting. Initially, the animals like cheetal, sambar, wild pig, these are not at all ready to associate these gaurs. Like whenever they see gaurs, they the alarm call, they ran off, or they have some disturb in their groups or other structures. Later on, it took almost 2 years to get this local accommodation. We have documented that, and we have almost communicated a paper, and meanwhile it got somewhere with the PIs, and it's unable to get published. So we are trying to publish that paper also, like how do this habitat remodeling with predator effect of reintroduced gaur, predator effect on reintroduced gaur. So whenever there is a predation occurs, these gaurs are trying to move out of the park, and or they move from their certain ranging aspect, like they leave their range, they move to a new area. When the tigers' numbers also slowly got increasing, these gaurs are trying to establish their own territory survivorship. So they then came the survivorship, then it came into the contact. So this gaur reintroduction also plays a big role in human-wildlife conflict, where these tigers are moving out of the park and killing cattle. After this, like after 3 years, this cattle lifting that has been drastically reduced because of they're getting the huge gaur inside. So this
really?
Also, yes, that. Sir, yes, sir.
Okay.
The predation rate, especially in Thala, Damokar side and the Mahaman side, it really drastically reduced. I literally observed this. Then this tiger relocation plan also we brought in the orphan tiger cubs which are kept inside the enclosure. We tried to relocate that, and with the help of radio collar, we want to study how closely the tigers and gaurs are playing. So then we use this camera trap data also, how closely gaurs and tigers have been associated. So that was the part one and part two. And the data are there, but we were unable to analyze and come with a solid papers, but their reports are there.
Right. Thank you.
The studies has been carried out. As well, you said, the studies has been observed and it has been carried out, but there is no concrete document on that.
Right.
It is slightly updated. Yes.
Right. I have one more question. This is my last question. Sir, often it has been observed in India that relocation projects are celebrated after relocating animals to the next habitat. Here in this case, they have been relocated successfully and have been studied after that successfully as well. But one aspect is there was a reason for the decline in the population in Bandhavgarh for the first years. And one of the hypotheses suggested that it might be the disease transfer between domestic cattle and the wild cattle. Was that aspect considered in the study after the relocation? Because during my recent visits to Bandhavgarh, I still see a lot of interaction between domestic cattle and the goas, especially around the periphery of the parks, which don't have fences.
I think that threat always looms with every
wild
population, because most of our national parks and wildlife sanctuaries are surrounded by human habitations where there's a lot of livestock. So that threat is there. If you ask, did we really look into those interactions? I don't know. Navneetan would be in a better position to explain. But the threat is always there with any wild population when it comes to, interaction with livestock in India.
Right, sir.
It's a very true, sir. Just want to add on Karthik sir's point. We also collected fresh pellet samples from all the herbivores like Nilgai, Sambar, Chital, along with domestic as well as wild goas. We started analyzing, they were disease were been transmitting, but not to a larger extent. It's not affecting the population.
Right.
So it has been documented. Yeah, it has been documented. Okay, and the report has been submitted to the office. So that's what I'm sure.
Perfect. Thanks you. Thank you, Navneetan.
Thank you.
David, I will take one last question and end this session because it's almost hour and a half since we started.
Okay.
So this question is from Dilip Kakavipure. Just like Gaur, there was Chital reintroduced in Tansa Wildlife Sanctuary, but the monitoring is difficult due to multiple reasons. What is suggested for the better rehabilitation? Sir, exactly, unless we know what are the multiple reasons and what difficulties that were faced in Tansa Wildlife Sanctuary, it will be difficult for us to comment on that. But, if someone, goes into those details of what difficulties are there, then always I'm sure some solution can be found to that problem. That's about it, David, from
Karthike, just can I comment for a second?
Sure, sir.
I think this is a very serious issue in all the succeeding translocation programs. Monitoring element is missing. I think every translocation program has to be accompanied by a long-term monitoring program. Money has to be allocated right away. And a scientific institution like WIA or maybe some institute from South India, they should be formally monitoring the animal rather than the forest department itself. The forest department doesn't have the capacity or the knowledge or even the time to do it. So you have to have a dedicated team, either it's one person or two person, 5 person, depending upon what kind of species you're dealing with. So Gaur, I think a major success was because Navneetan and party, they were all on the Gaur 24/7, and we knew where the animals were going, whether they were getting into danger, whether they had to be herded back, blah, blah, blah. And our Bharat India program, I think, is suffering because there's no monitoring from Wildlife Institute of India, and very little information is being collected, and we really don't know what's happening. The animals which were released, how many herd they have split into, where they are moving every day, and what needs to be done about them. So that's not happening. I think this must be a absolute necessity, but wherever you plan a translocation program, 5-year monitoring program by a scientific institute, by dedicated researchers, has to be part of the project itself. Thank you.